President Obama spent the day on the road and back at the White House lobbying for a tax cut deal that may be winning Republican support, but has angered members of his own party. As Democrats and Republicans neared agreement on extending tax cuts for the middle class and the wealthy, President Obama today urged compromise. He spoke in Winston-Salem, North Carolina.
We've got to make sure that we're coming up with a solution, even if it's not 100% of what I want or what the Republicans want. Now, there's no reason that ordinary Americans should see their taxes go up next year.
But the president is hoping to exact something in exchange for his concession on tax cuts for the wealthy, which he once pledged to roll back completely. With the national jobless rate nearing 10%, he wants lawmakers to extend unemployment insurance as well. In Washington yesterday, Senate Republican leader Mitch McConnell all but claimed victory.
I think it's pretty clear now taxes are not going up on anybody in the middle of this recession. We're discussing how long we should maintain current tax rates. And there are other issues that many people feel are important to address.
Democratic senators spent their weekend making the case against compromise, failing in two efforts to exempt the highest earners from the reduced tax burden.
Our friends on the other side.
New York Democrat Chuck Schumer proposed one plan that would have allowed only those earning up to $1 million a year to qualify.
I think this is correct substantively. I think it's high ground politically. And I think in the past, Democrats have sort of, when we've had these kinds of cases, we've sort of thrown up our hands. We're not going to.
Seeking to allay the concerns of the party's most liberal wing, Vice President Biden and President Obama met with party leaders this weekend and again this afternoon. Their message, this may be the best deal they can get. Yes. Utah Senator Orrin Hatch was among the Republicans suggesting this weekend that the deal may be close to done. He appeared on CNN.
We're willing, it seems to me, we're willing to kick this over for about two or three, well, I'd like it permanent, but we can't. We don't have the vote. Kick it over. Let's take care of the unemployment compensation, even if it isn't, backed up by real finances. So we've got to do it, so let's do it. But that ought to be it.
And Federal Reserve Chairman Ben Bernanke, appearing on 60 Minutes, warned that any year-end budget action should not upset the fragile economy.
We need to pay close attention to the fact that we are recovering now. We don't want to take actions this year that will affect this year's spending and this year's taxes in a way that will hurt the recovery. That's important.
The timing on any tax cut agreement and vote remains up in the air.
The outline of the deal Democratic lawmakers are being asked to consider tonight also includes a temporary 2% payroll tax cut, an expansion in the amount of expenses businesses can write off, and a compromise on the estate tax. But as the search for bipartisan agreement takes a backseat to the fight for intra-party agreement, some Democrats are asking what price compromise. It's turning into a bitter divide within the Democratic Party. Here to discuss it are Jane Hamsher, founder and publisher of the liberal blog FireDogLeg.com, and Jim Kessler, vice president for policy at Third Way, a centrist Democratic think tank. I always have trouble saying FireDogLeg.com, Jane Hamsher. Some Democrats like you say that this deal is a cave-in. Others say this is the best you can get. Why?
Well, of particular concern to me, all the details haven't come out tonight, are the 2% payroll tax cut that is ostensibly being proposed. That's been a Republican idea that they've been pushing for a long time in order to sort of starve the beast of the Social Security Trust Fund. It means that money will not be coming into the trust fund, but benefits will still be paid out. Up until now, the trust fund has been solvent and it's been able to pay out its own benefits. But in this plan, they're basically trying to reduce the solvency of the trust fund because they couldn't get a benefit cut through the Cat Food Commission. They're just not going to stop until they try.
So you think that basically the president and his the people who support him on this are caving into Republican ideals, not Democratic ones?
Well, you know, the whole idea for the Deficit Commission, the Cat Food Commission, was the president's.
I wondered what you meant when you said Cat Food Commission.
He's the one who issued the executive order, and they very much considered one of their fundamental challenges to be able to fix Social Security. But as Nancy Altman, who was one of the president's advisors on Social Security, says, it is ridiculous that this idea is coming from the Democrats. And anybody who gets Social Security or ever hopes to get Social Security should be very concerned that the Republicans are finally getting a foothold into it like this.
Why shouldn't liberals be upset that the president is giving away too much of the store?
Look, I come from a centrist organization. I don't love the plan either. I mean, I think it's, you know, the tax cuts for those over $250,000, I think it's dubious economic value. At a time we can't really afford it. It'll have to be paid back by future generations.
Do I hear a but coming?
To Chinese holders of our debt. Yeah, look, there's a new reality out there that I don't love, but it's the reality, and that is, you know, they're going to have to find bipartisan compromises on these things. I don't know if this was the best plan the president could get or the best plan that Democrats could get, but this is, you know, after the election, there's a whole new ball game going on right now. And as much as we don't love this plan, my guess is the American people are probably going to like it. They want to see the two parties work together, even if it's something that neither of them really like. And I just want to add one other thing. President and Republicans and Democrats agreed on 85% of the tax cut plans going in on this. The whole debate has been about the other 15%. It's an important 15%, but that's what that debate has been on.
So if there's only 15% that you disagree on, why not embrace the plan and say this is, the White House is saying, you know, we're getting $40 billion in tax cut, we're getting a huge temporary investment incentive. Why not just embrace that and go?
Well, look, because you always want to do better than what you can get, but look, I just think that this extra $700 billion in tax breaks for people who are very wealthy, I just don't think it's got a real value for our economy right now. I disagree with Republicans who say that it does, and we can't afford it. We've got a huge deficit, but this is the best that we can get, and this is what we're, you know, this is what's going to pass.
What would you like to see Jane Hamsher or the White House do other than the best it can get?
Well,
I guess is the word I'm looking for.
I think this is what the president wanted. I think it's pretty indisputable that this is what he has seriously tried to work for.
This was not the compromise. This was always the goal.
I don't think this was a compromise. Organizing for America, his organization, never went out on the tax cuts. Chuck Schumer was trying to get a compromise through at $1 million rather than $250,000 worth of income, and the president fought against that. He doesn't want to be the president who's running against on having raised taxes in 2012. But the problem is that that's what he tells America that he wants. So you've got this problem, this dissonance between what he's saying and what he appears to want. And people are very confused and they're very frustrated. I'd like him to be honest and make the argument with the American people that why he thinks this is a good idea.
Is this residual bad feeling left over from other debates which liberals have lost with this White House, like the public option debate during the health care?
You know, this is weird. It's different. I didn't think people were going to get that upset about this, but they are. And particularly here in D.C., you had many of the president's strongest supporters are federal employees who were willing to take a tax cut, a freeze on their wages for the good of the country.
Which the president did call for last week.
But now they're seeing that wage increase go to pay for millionaires, for, you know, for people who make more than $1 million a year. It's going out the door for that. And we're seeing, you know, the destruction of the Social Security Trust Fund. I mean, these are the things that really, really bother people. They're willing to make sacrifice, but not for millionaires.
I don't think this is the destruction of the Social Security Trust Fund at all. I think it's a completely different debate. Look, here's the problem the Democrats had. Going into this debate, I counted 6 different tax cut compromise proposals that Democrats proposed that all were being debated. Republicans had 1. If you go into a position where you've got 1 negotiating position and the other side has 6, that one is going to win. Now, you could argue, gee, the president should have gathered everybody together and unified Democrats around one thing. I've been involved with the Democratic Party for 22 years. It's just not something we do very well. I do think it's similar to the public option, which was you could see down the line when the public option was being debated that there was absolutely no chance a public option could get into that bill. There was never the votes. There was never going to be the votes. Here, there was never a real chance that just 250 and leaving the rest of the tax cuts behind was going to be the final solution. We had to figure out a place where we wanted to go. We had to have 1 position. Never happened.
Is this the beginning of a slippery slope involving other Democratic priorities, like the Don't Ask, Don't Tell, the Dream Immigration Reform Act, the START Treaty, where you see the president or the White House or people who agree with him in Congress bargaining away Democratic positions?
Yes, and if you look at the Korea Free Trade Agreement that was announced on Friday, you know, that was another one of the president's tentpole promises on the campaign trail, that he was going to repeal the provisions of NAFTA and CAFTA that were very bad for labor, were bad for the environment, and were bad for jobs in the United States. And yet on Friday, they announced another trade deal with Korea, basically the one negotiated by George Bush, that gives the Korean that gives them everything they want in exchange for military presence, basically, in South Korea. I mean, people are upset about these
things.
What do
you say to that?
The Korea Free Trade Agreement is a great deal for the United States. And if you really want to see how good a deal it is, watch the protests in Korea, how upset they are about it, because they think that America got the best deal. Look, I think that I don't love this tax deal at all. But I'm a bit more optimistic about what can be accomplished in this divided government Congress coming up than a lot of folks are. I do think we have a decent chance with Don't Ask, Don't Tell. I think we do have a decent chance on immigration reform, even with a Republican House. I think there will be progress made on some of the trade agreements like
Korea.
Not
in the lame duck, necessarily.
Not in the lame duck. But, you know, I think there's a greater opportunity for compromise and progress than we think. And just one final thing. The president got 90% of what he wanted, and so did Democrats, on the health care bill. That was one of the biggest accomplishments of any presidency since 1965 under Medicare. Let's not talk about Democrats as caving. That's a big accomplishment.
So let's talk about 2012 briefly, because we know that that's what people have turned to, that the president has weakened himself among his base and will have a difficult time in 2012. Does this fight resonate, or does it that go away between now and 2000?
It seems like it's going to be sticking in people's craws, that this was really the big issue that they cared about. But I will argue on the South Korea free trade deal that you've got, you know, we've lost 45,000 factories since NAFTA passed and 5.5 million jobs. And the Tea Parties overwhelmingly opposed free trade deals. And the reason they were rioting in Korea is because they don't like the fact that their government has to accept the jurisdiction of foreign courts any more than Americans do. The president campaigned to stop all of that. And during this 2010 election, that was one of the number one issues that Democrats won on. 210 ads that were produced against these things.
Is it going to resonate in 2012?
First, I just want to say we lost those jobs to China. We don't have a trade agreement with China.
Okay, we'll have a trade debate another time. I would really like you to answer the question.
I think, ironically, the 2012 debate will be about the Bush tax cuts, Iraq, and Afghanistan, and that's what the 2008 debate was about.
Jim Kessler, Jane Hamsher, thank you both very much.
Thank you.